You know, you can decide to train your mouth this year. You can put your mouth in a training class. Since you know that your mouth gives access to God's power, train it to speak what God will walk with. Train your mouth to speak what God will walk with. Don't allow your mouth give Satan access. Train your mouth to speak words that God can use. We saw from scriptures how that your words can corrupt another person. In James chapter 3 verse 1, look at James chapter 3 verse 1. Brother James says, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." Next verse 2. "For in many things we offend all. If any of any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man and able also to bridle the whole body." Next verse. "Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body." Next verse. "Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth." Next verse. "Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasted great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth." Next verse. "And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell." That is, your tongue determines the destination of your life. Your tongue determines the outcome of your life. Putting your body under will be a function of your words. Your words will put your body under. If you want to break a habit or you want to break addiction, it begins with what you say. If a man is addicted to something and he wants to be free from it, he has to start saying the right words, because your mouth will channel the power of God that will ultimately free you from that addiction or habit. You've got to mind what you say. In a humorous way, you've got to mind your language. You mind your language. You mind your language. Say with me very loud, "I acknowledge what God says I am. I affirm who God says I am. And I can do what God says I can do." I thought somebody would shout hallelujah. So you first of all affirm the reality of what you will practice in whatever you say. The world is so loose. This world is a loose world. Therefore, you must decide to speak the word only. There is nothing wrong if you decide to speak the word of God all the time. Nobody will beat you. People say, "How are you doing?" "Oh, the word of God is working in my circumstances." It looks like you're not doing well in business. No, the word of God is working and my needs are met according to his riches in glory. Glory to God. You speak the word of God all the time. "How are you doing?" "Fine." "What is fine?" "What is fine?" "How are you doing?" "The word of God is working mightily in my circumstances. I am blessed and I am ahead of all the situations around." So that way you are channeling God's power to get involved. No careless moments. No careless moments. At all the time you are guarded. You are speaking how forcible are right words. Stop trying to impress people at the detriment of your life. Speak what God says and speak what you know God will work with. Don't just speak because you want to speak. Speak because you believe what you are saying and because you know that those words will give access to the power of God. He says, "By the many words." Whose words? Peter's words. See what Peter said in Acts chapter 5 verse 20. Acts chapter 5 verse 20. "Go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." All the words of this life. He says, "Send for a man called Peter, that he may speak words whereby you shall be saved." Words. "And while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on those who heard." So Peter's words channeled the power of God. Peter's words directed the power of God. Put value on your words as a child of God. I mean, imagine the pictures of an angel that Peter saw did not bring salvation. An encounter with the angel did not bring salvation. The salvation came to the house of Cornelius by what Peter said. Even the presence of an angel couldn't deliver it. It took Peter to speak after the encounter for men to be saved. That's how important words are. If salvation came via speaking, then I can see that many things God will do on the earth can only be done by speaking. As serious as salvation is, it came by speaking. Every other thing God will do on the earth will function by speaking. After all, when we pray, we are speaking. When we pray, speaking. When we prophesy, we are speaking. So what else is not done through speaking? In Romans chapter 10 verse 8, say not in your heart, who shall go to the grave to bring Christ down? Out. Say not in your heart, who shall go up to heaven to bring Christ down? What saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Next verse. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Say not in your heart, but what saith it? He said it so often that when he got to verse 9 and 10, he says, with your heart you believe, with your mouth you confess. So salvation or speaking, being filled with the Spirit, speaking, salvation, speaking, prophesying, speaking, there's a whole lot of what God does on the earth through speaking. When your mouth is quiet, you hinder the power of God. You hinder the acts of God in your life. And you hinder the acts of God on the earth. My mouth is not just for eating amala, apu, and afang. Beyond that, my mouth gives the power of God access to the earth. If you don't speak it, don't expect it. If you don't say it, don't expect it. Because ultimately you shall have only what you say. The power of God is at work in my body. Kayadaba. The power of God is at work in my circumstances. The power of God is at work in my family. Praise God. I say praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So my mouth is an access for the power of God in the earth today. Words whereby you might be saved. How did Jesus know his disciples were afraid? By what they said. Master, carest thou not that we perish? Those are fear-filled words. And Jesus stood up and said, peace, be still. He called the things that be not as though they were. What was available? Perish. Threat to life. What did Jesus say? He didn't say threat. He didn't say confusion. He said peace, which is the opposite of the circumstance. He called the things that be not as though they were. You feel pain? You shout help. You feel weakness? You shout strength. You call the things that be not. Don't call the things that are as though they are not. That's not what you are told. You are told to call the things that be not. Speak the expected end. Speak the expected end and speak it all the time. I am what the word says I am. In other words, the same way fear is accessed into the earth by words, fear will die unborn when it is not uttered. Fear will die unborn when it is not uttered. Till you give it the same legitimate right in your words, it will die unborn. So Jesus knew that they were afraid by what they said. By what they say. My mouth, therefore, it's God's access into the earth. My mouth brings salvation. My mouth brings direction. My mouth brings healing. Instead of saying, I don't know what to do, I am a bit confused, open your mouth and say, I know what to do. My steps are ordered by the Lord. My mind understands God's purpose in this situation. My mind factors out God's design, God's plan. I am not confused. I have clarity. I know exactly what to do, and I do what I need to do. Glory to God. I am not confused. I have direction. My steps are ordered by the Lord, and I do what is right. You say it and say it until you know what to do. You say it and say it until you know what to do. I have direction. I have clarity. I have precision. I have accuracy. I'm not doing trial and error. My mind is educated by my spirit to do what is right. You speak the words that God will walk with. What about saying, I know I am led. by the Spirit of God. I know I am walking in the light. I know what to do, when to do it. There's no occasion of stumbling here. My steps are ordered by the Lord. What about saying that? I walk in the light. I walk in the light. Oh, I walk in the light. The word of God is a lamp to my feet. There's no occasion of stumbling. I do not beat about the bush. I have clarity. I know exactly where to step into, when to step in there, and when not to step in there. I intentionally take my steps. I do not accidentally stumble. No, intentionally, my steps are calculated. And they are calculated with precision. When I move with accuracy, because my steps are ordered. You speak words that God will walk with. Am I teaching good? Yeah. When things get out of control, hold yourself together and say, God supplies my need. God supplies my need. You speak words that the Holy Ghost will walk with. Teaching good? What you're doing is you're giving access to God's power on the earth. You're giving direction. Yeah. Imagine Jesus saying every idle word a man speaks, he will give account. That's heavy. One of the examples we have about Jesus in scripture is there is no guile found in his mouth. No guile found in Jesus' mouth. In fact, 1 Peter 2:21 says, when he was reviled, he reviled not. When he was reviled, he reviled not. So my words are vital. There is no way I will glorify God when I glorify sickness and disease. You sit down and give us the history of the disease. You give us the history. We don't need it. Whether you give us the history or not, the important thing is you need healing. So don't bore us. Don't overwhelm us with your evidence. There's a way somebody will tell you about their problem. Even you that is about to pray, you will not find the prayer. You will not find the prayer. And there are people that are very good at that. And the reason is because they are looking for sympathy. They are not looking for healing. So such people end up with sympathy. Sorry, oh, sorry, oh, sorry, oh, sorry, sorry. God will do it. Sorry. Shay, you use 1 hour to tell me about the sickness. The 1 hour I will have used to tell you about your healing, you use it to narrate the story. All right, no problem. We agree that is what it is. Sorry. Whatever the sickness is, if you allow us to give you the word of God, even you may not have the details of the sickness, but the word of God will factor it out. When Jesus spoke, it went to the root of the tree. The word of God is not blind. It will trace it wherever it is hiding, and it will bring it out. It will clear it. We don't care about the analysis. We're not interested in the X-ray report. We are not interested in the medical name. Kukukukukukus. We are not interested. The important thing is that your body is not well. You want to be well, right? Be healed in the name of Jesus. And God's healing power will go right to the root of that sickness and take it out. Somebody say, I hear you. Sometimes the diagnosis the doctor gave you may not be accurate, but the power of God never misses it. No, the power of God is always accurate. Even if the medical analysis, the prognosis of the doctor is inaccurate, when God's power is channeled by the words we speak, they will go to the root of that problem and trace it to wherever it's hiding and take care of it. I believe in miracles. I say 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 God's power is working in my body. Oh, Jacola da Baba. Somebody shout, God's power is working in my body. No matter how you describe the sickness, it does not glorify God. No matter how you describe it, it does not glorify God. God only gets glory when he heals it. God heals. He heals the sick. He raises the dead. He cleanses the lepers. I say those words because my words are meant to glorify God. My words matter. It gives access to God in the earth realm. I therefore yield my words to the power of God. Say with me, I yield my words to the power of God. I yield my words to the power of God. Not to my experiences. Not to doubt. Not to anxiety. Not to worry. But to the power of God. The healing power of God is available to me right now. I yield my words to God's healing power. I yield my words to the healing power. I don't use my words to announce symptoms. I use my words to announce God's healing. I do not use my words to announce and describe how I feel. I yield my words to God's power. My words will not cooperate with the symptoms. My words cooperate with the healing power of God. The power of God is at work in my body right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. My natural human mind wants me to discuss symptoms, but symptoms don't glorify God. So I suspend my mind and I speak by my spirit. The power of God is at work in my body. Pain does not stay. Disease does not hide in my body. I have been bought with a price. Therefore, I glorify God by healing in my body. I receive healing. I receive miracles. I receive healing, curative healing, curative healing, restorative healing. I receive miracles for my body right now. Every organ of my body functions well. I thought I'll hear a powerful amen. The power of God is at work in my body right now. Hallelujah. You know, when you tell people about your problem, your sickness and your disease, you have a temporary relief because you discuss. But after the discussion, it increases. When you pour out your heart, I'm looking for somebody to pour out my heart. I want to pour out my heart. You know, when you pour out your heart, you have a temporary relief. But you can decide to put the word of God in your lips and say what God says until your body conforms with God's realities. Praise God. In Mark chapter 5 and Romans chapter 4, somebody getting blessed tonight. In Mark chapter 5 and Romans chapter 4, we're gonna look at it quickly. The symptoms could be very real. They wake you up at night. They remind you early in the morning. You touch your body, you feel the symptoms of what has happened or what is happening. But you can put God's word on your lips and use the word of God in your mouth to chase out the symptoms. Give access to God's power. In Mark chapter 5, let's examine something critical. The woman heard of Jesus. Question, what are you hearing? What do you spend your whole day listening to? What do you spend your whole night listening to? The woman heard of Jesus. She heard of the power of God. She said, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know I shall be whole. But she said, the Greek word is continuous. She kept saying, if I can but touch. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to narrate somebody's experience. If I can but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be whole. She kept saying it. Observe. She has been treated by many doctors for 12 years. Which means the symptoms were there. Imagine symptoms for 12 years. And the Bible says she got worse. You know, there's a way you get used to pain. Pain becomes natural. You know, there's a way you have so much pain that it affects the way you walk. So because of the pain, you look for a comfort zone. And the comfort zone for that pain is to walk like this. And because you have adjusted to the pain has become your normal, your new normal. But it does not remove the pain. The pain is still there. It's just that you have adjusted to accommodate the pain and accept the pain as part of your life. No, it doesn't have to be a part of your life. That woman could have continued bleeding. But after 12 years, she said, no, how long will I continue like this? How long? No, no, there must be a way out. Then she heard of Jesus. Oh, that is what I was waiting for. If I can touch the hem of his garment, I know I shall be whole. No disease is normal. No disease is normal. No sickness is normal. How important are our words? She said. Observe. In Jairus's case, they told Jairus, don't trouble the master any longer. You know, sometimes even a preacher can transmit fear. Some preachers will tell you, well, you know, this is your problem. We just have to believe God. Kenneth Hagin said when he was bedridden on the bed, his grandma told him that a priest was coming to pray for him. The priest entered, encouraged him, and told him, don't worry, everything will be okay. My son, everything will be okay. Then he entered the next room and was asking the grandma, what kind of burial does he want? And the priest didn't know that Ken Hagin was hearing them. They were arranging for his burial. They were arranging for his burial, but he kept meditating the scriptures. Mark 11:23. Whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast to the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things he says shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever things he says. What things soever you desire, when you pray, believe you receive, and you shall have. By his stripes I was healed. Then one morning he said, as he was lying down and rehearsing those scriptures in meditation, the Lord said to him, will you be healed or you are healed? He said, I am healed. He said, what do people who get healed do? He said, they move. So if you're healed, what are you still doing on the bed? This is somebody that has not moved for, I think, 16 months. Lying down on the bed paralyzed for 16 months. 1 year, 4 months. But before he acted in his faith, he told grandma, grandma, go to the market. Buy me shoes. I'll be with you tomorrow morning in the breakfast table. The grandma said, why don't you get well first before we buy the shoe? He said, grandma, you go right now, buy me shoes. I'll be with you tomorrow morning at the breakfast table. That is nothing stops faith. Grandma went to the market to buy shoes. As soon as she left, Hagin said he moved his body from the bed to the edge and turned. And for the first time, dropped his two legs. Needles began to run through the leg. He felt like he was going to faint. He waited for a while and moved his bum off the bed, came down, put the first step down, stood up and staggered like he will fall. He said, by his stripes, I am healed. I am healed. If I am healed, I cannot be lying down. By his stripes, I am healed. He took the second step. He staggered. After a while, he stabilized. He took the third step. He took the fourth step. He took the fifth step. He got to the door and walking back towards the bed. Grandma came back with shoes. Grandma opened the door and saw Hagin standing. He said, grandma, I told you. I told you tomorrow morning I'll be with you in the breakfast table. Where are my shoes? Where are my shoes? Oh, glory to God. Where are my shoes? And from that day, he has been alive until he was satisfied and decided to sleep at 80-something. This bedridden was at the age of 16 or so. He lived from 16 to 80-something. He refused the doctor's word. Your words will channel the power, or your words will stifle the power. It's in the power of your mouth. This woman kept saying. You know, sometimes you can give somebody a medical report without transmitting fear. You can describe a situation without, you know, concluding in fear. Yeah, it's true that there is pain in your body, but Jesus took it. The power of God is working in your body. You don't deny the fact. Faith does not deny the fact. Faith doesn't say there is no mountain. Faith doesn't say there is no sickness. After all, Jesus said to the blind man, what do you want? He said, sight. Jesus said, receive your sight. Jesus didn't say, no, you are not blind. He didn't say, no, you are not blind. He says, okay, I agree. Receive your sight. He said, whosoever shall say to this mountain. So he recognizes that there is a mountain, but the mountain will be removed. We don't deny. We're not saying deny that there is pain in your body. What we're saying is that there may be pain in your body, but the power of God is heavier than the pain. The power of God is more real than the pain in that body. Praise God. Jesus spoke God's word.